Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure to be here and to be able to transmit the best congratulations and best wishes for the next 50 years. Thinking that, you know, while it is true in the 60s, many big and important institutions were initiated, also in Switzerland, because after the war, some money, you know, was about, and that usually helps, besides intelligence. But we also mustn't forget that most of these institutions have a reason for being there where they are, like Heidelberg, because there was initiation in the 20s. The same is true in Lausanne, for example, for the Swiss Cancer Institute. You know, things have a history, and I think it's good to think of history because we all stand on the shoulders of giants, as we say. What I want to talk about today is that in biomedical research, things are not black and white, but there are things that are highly probable, quite frequent, and there are other things that are extremely rare, but some people hide behind the rareness and say, you cannot exclude that it might be important. Now, I will usually take the position on if it's important, then it has an impact on a very simple readout, and the readout in medicine is legs up or legs down. Very honest, and you cannot cheat. So, if you look at the situation as to the immune system, then it's clear the immune system is only efficient against some viruses, but not against many others. Same true for bacterial infections, parasites. It's always a balanced situation, as it is with certain tumors. But I will tell you that tumors have not been programmed into the immune system primarily, because we are all built to survive to 20, maybe 22 years. We don't need more to fulfill our biological function. Why? Because we just have to place the next generation, and all the rest is luxury. So having accepted that, of course, now we can go into the details. Where are the problems? And the problems are that, you know, as long as in these fringe areas, the host is not killed before 22, the co-evolutionary balance is rather stable. So the viruses that kill you are the ones we call classically childhood infections, against which we have very efficient vaccines. And of course, evolution had to build a very highly specific immune system response, because otherwise we wouldn't sit here together. So if we now look at these fringe areas, I think we have a chance from approaching the limiting conditions from either side. We can go from the immune system side or the infectious or tumor situation. So that's basically what I will try to do and come up with two major conclusions. You know, chronic infections are the problem of the aging population. Aging means after 22. Because the immune system, you know, contrary to general belief nowadays in nature and science, is not regulated to avoid autoimmunity. There are very simple rules to avoid the system to react against self-antigens. And this is very obvious because tumors and autoimmune diseases are the diseases after 30 years of age, not before. And before 20, it's surviving acute, pathogenic, cytopathic infections, period. So before 20, you don't worry about regulation because you have to survive. And after 30, you start to worry about regulation, be it in the financial world or in immunology. But you all know regulation is too complex, too difficult to really be installed. And when you think about regulation, the next question must be, who regulates the regulators? A huge problem, also in immunology. So, we have the chronic infections, and of course, this always goes with inflammation. And inflammation, and there I like that, Harald Zuhausen is here, because that's his sort of innuendo. Of course, you have chronic regeneration, and therefore you have a tumor. Whether that infection comes from the outside, from meat, or whatever, doesn't really matter. But it doesn't kill you before 22. Now, of course, anti-solid tumor immune responses, that's what we all dream of. But we don't have it. And why don't we have it? Because any efficient anti-solid tumor immunity will be equivalent to immunopathology, or you could call it autoimmunity. So you can't have it both ways, Either you have an anti-tumor response that is very efficient, and then you also buy autoimmunity or immunopathology. And of course, there is no such thing as a free lunch, also in biology. And then I will, in the end, talk about some, ideas immunologists have, which I think are wrong. Okay, now the second general issue is we cannot do better than evolution if we use the same tools. Of course, this is a trivial statement because, in contrast to a postdoc or a doctoral student, evolution has time. Very much time. So we do better than evolution if we introduce new tools that evolution has not used, like antibiotics, antivirals, cytotoxic drugs and all these things. So yes, I'm not pessimistic about the situation, but I think we should have some respect for evolution because it's really extraordinary. I will give you some examples. Now let's start with my summary course in immunology, it's just 2-3 slides, because immunology is actually very, very simple. You see, there are two issues. A virus, but you could do the same with bacteria or parasites, infects a cell and either destroys it or doesn't. Actually, many more infections are of the left-hand side type, because an infectious agent cannot have as a goal to kill all hosts. Otherwise, it would be gone. So the acute cytopathic infections, that's what kills you before age 15 to 20. And there, an efficient neutralizing antibody response is key to survival, because that prevents the virus to get to the brain. And since you only have one brain, that's it. And the other ones, in fact, an immune response is actually harmful. Why? Because the cell that replicates the virus wouldn't be destroyed unless a cell-mediated immune response would recognize that the cell is infected and would destroy the infected host cell. So that we call immunopathology. And how is that co-evolutionarily avoided? Well, simply, these infections jump from a virus-carrying mother to the offspring at the time when the offspring is immuno-incompetent, which means before birth or at birth, with that small blood transfusion, which means you avoid the immunopathology, the virus gets transmitted, a fantastic co-evolutionary balance. So, now, if you look at a virus, any, polio, measles, and bacteria, the same, parasites, the key characteristic of any infectious agent is a highly repetitive, multimeric expression of identical determinants on their surfaces. And that induces an an extraordinarily efficient IgM response, antibody response, that is directed against these outermost determinants, the tips of these glycoproteins, and these molecules are so big they cannot enter. So the only, let's say, mark of the foreign intruder is usually at the top of these outer membrane repetitive molecules. Very efficient response. And therefore, these neutralizing antibodies are shown in these negative stainings stuck on the surface will be key for survival. Now, what I've said means that against a virus that is cytopathic, cell-destructive, you call the immune response immunoprotective. That's the normal thing. If, you know, the virus is known, is non-cytopathic, then you call the immune response immunopathologic. If you don't know the infection, or the etiology, or the bacterium, or the parasites, or the virus, then you call it autoimmunity. Because pathophysiologically and histologically, the processes are identical. So I'm not saying, you know, 100% of autoimmunity is etiologically explainable by chronic infections. But the problem, of course, is that the incidence, that is the original etiology, and the immunopathology may take 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 years, like in chronic cancer. So etiology would be nice, not only in cancer etiology, but also in autoimmunity, because you could do something about it. And I think that's always the best way to deal with medical problems. Now, the last immunology slide is really, we have no immune response if the virus keeps out of the lymph node or the spleen, such as the papillomavirus. It's a wonderful example where a tumor actually starts growing because the virus infects the germinal cell layer in the skin, but doesn't replicate yet. It's only when differentiating into keratinocytes that the virus starts replicating. And by that time, of course, the virus is out of reach of Langerhans cells and all the rest of it. So things happen, but the immune system is out of it. And the other configuration is, if the virus is transmitted from mother to offspring at birth, then the virus is, of course, everywhere. And this means the virus is considered immunologically as self and no reaction, because otherwise the immune response would cause a generalized sort of host versus graft or graft versus host reaction, which would kill the host immediately. HIV is an example, or aggressive hepatitis, of course. So with this introduction, let's go to papillomavirus. And this is, of course, a pleasure to do that here, because I think it's a very interesting problem that has not been solved. The fact that the anti-papillomavirus vaccine basically works, or delays, let's be modest, maybe delays the incubation period from 40 years to 100 years, simply tells you that reducing infection is good. And we have other examples I don't want to mention. So this is the tumor, and you know, usually Langerhans cells would be down here. So the question really a papillomavirus infection poses is, how and are T cells induced? Because the infection problem can be solved with neutralizing antibodies. Very easy. But what T cells are induced? Are they only T helper cells of the CD4 type? Or can CD8 effector T cells be induced? Because at the end of the day, your wart, but also your pharyngiocarcinoma is basically a CD8 problem to a certain extent. So we can talk about then about cross-presentation. Now, you know, papillomaviruses are not an exception. Well, they are rare because they can't be cytopathic, otherwise you wouldn't be allowed to make an infection and not killing the host. But there are other highly cytopathic viruses, and one is, you know, rhabdoviruses, for example, rabies virus, that preferentially is neurotropic, so, you know, basically from the periphery infects axons, and this is shown here. And by the, you know, during that period where the virus is basically in the axon, nothing happens because, again, it's out of the reach of any immune reactivity. Keeps out of lymph nodes. And what we do with post-exposure vaccination is simply sticking these antigens basically into the lymph node. I mean, we do it subcutaneously in general. But basically, that's the pathway. So now you try to induce an antibody response before that virus reaches too many neurons to basically make you mad, or even madder than before. Now, this contrasts, of course, with, let's say, TB. TB, we don't have a vaccine. Why? Because basically, having a TB granuloma and, you know, the dinosaurs amongst us, certainly are likely to have a TB granuloma, and that TB granuloma is well controlled immunologically. You know, it's a nicely organized, you could almost call it a lymph node-like structure with macrophages and all sorts of things, and the bacilli are contained. So I'm immune against my TB. So I'm not sick. I think I'm not sick. But these bacilli, you know, get drained to the draining lymph nodes every once in a while, and that boosts the immune response, and that controls or enhances the control in the granuloma. So it's a ping-pong game between infection and immune response. And in a way, that's the classical situation which immunologists like to call memory. Of course, it's not memory. It's antigen-driven activation of an immune response. And if you take the antigen away, this response and this resistance simply falls flat. And this is why a BCG vaccine doesn't work. Because the BCG vaccine against TB is kicked out after about a year. And then this whole ongoing re-stimulation disappears. So, now if you just think one step ahead, you know, if this were a tumor, which it almost is, then you could deduce from this finding that even if you had a good cell-mediated immune response against your tumor, you wouldn't necessarily be capable of kicking it out, like this granuloma. So it's not good enough just to induce a few T cells. It's much more complicated. So let's do that in a model situation. In our lab, with Hans Hengarten and Pam Ohashi, we generated a mouse that expresses under the rat insulin promoter a glycoprotein from the virus we like best, LCMV. And now you have a mouse with expressing that glycoprotein only in islet cells. And then you wait and look whether the mouse develops a diabetes, and it doesn't happen. So you say, well, the mouse must be tolerant, you know, classically tolerant. But if you infect the same mouse with the virus from which you have taken this gene, you immediately have an excellent cytotoxic CD8 T cell response, and within 8 days, all the islets are gone. So the mouse is not tolerant, it's reactive. But as long as the antigen stays only in the islets, that is away from lymph nodes and spleen, there's no immune response. And as soon as you bring in the virus into the lymph node or spleen, you immediately induce these CTLs. So that's a very simple principle that the immune system actually is not non-reactive against most self-antigens that are in the periphery. It is non-reactive against everything in the lymphohematopoietic system. And as soon as you bring in the peripheral antigen into a lymph node under, let's call them TB or infectious disease conditions, then you will immediately make a very potent immune response. And of course, this
you then call autoimmune diabetes?
Well, you see already, as I've tried to say, words are easy because they may actually indicate something completely different. So, now let's take the same situation and you can simply consider the transgenic or transgene expressing islet cells as a tumor, because no difference. You know, you could call it an insulinoma. It doesn't kill you by growing. It's simply sitting there in the periphery and you want to get rid of it. So if you infect this mouse with the virus, that is like an atom bomb. It really goes like crazy, induces immune responses up to your ears. Within 8 days, you have an acute diabetes. All the islets are gone. That is 100%. If, however, you infect with a vaccine, a recombinant that expresses the same glycoprotein, you only get a, let's call it, a 10% immune response. So you get some killing, but you don't get a diabetes because, you know, diabetes only starts when 90-95% of the islets are gone. So that's the safety margin of all physiology in humans. It's like an old farmhouse, you know, where they use thick construction material. If the worms ate off 90%, the house didn't fall down. And it's quite similar. So now we do an additional experiment. We take the glycoprotein peptides. That's what tumor immunologists do. You know, you isolate it, find the peptide, you immunize. Nothing happens. You know, you don't have a diabetes. And just remember, in autoimmune disease, you know, it's a bit like to get rid of a tumor. You need to get rid of more than 95, if not 100%. Otherwise, it's not efficient. So now you change because you know that an infection has a completely different kinetics than just once injecting a peptide. So you do it daily or two daily or three daily, sort of, you know, you even can increase the amount of peptide. And then you see over 30 to 40 days, you see a very interesting chronic form of diabetes. This is completely different also morphologically from the CD8 acute lytic diabetes in this case. And when you look at the histology in this last case, you find, you know, what we like to call tertiary type of lymphatic structures in the islet. You have B-cell areas, you have T-cell areas, you have an autoantibody response going on. So all the hallmarks of a classical antibody-dependent autoimmune pathology. So this is like a classical, you know, slow-onset juvenile type of diabetes. And you see, you can manipulate, of course, in so-called basic immunology, what you want to get. So if you want to show that cytotoxic T cells are important, you take this method. If you want to show that CD4 autoantibody are important, you take this long-term. But I think the long-term is much more adequate to make the point. Now, just a small additional point. If you take a mouse and you immunize it with the peptide, and you look at the islets, let's say 8 days or 6 days before, for MHC class 1 was mentioned, you know, very important presenter molecules, you don't find them, or very low expression. But after an LCMV infection, you know, it's highly expressed in these islet cells. So, you know, there are additional factors, interferons, many other things play a major role. So if you use this peptide and you now add interferon, you know, your CTLs suddenly become very efficient. So I don't want to oversimplify, simply try to make it as simple as possible. Now, let's look at this peptide immunization in a different situation. Here we immunize simply normal mice in two different ways. Either we take a peptide and inject it daily.
similar to the diabetes model. Or we take the peptide together with incomplete or complete French adjuvant.
Now, you know, adjuvants has been called by Janeway the dirty little trick of immunologists. But what it simply does, you know, it creates a depot. Doesn't do much more. You just take an oil droplet and put the antigen there, and the oil will stay for weeks. So, let's look at the immune response. If you immunize with peptide, and then, you know, after you do that six times, or you immunize once with this complete or incomplete French adjuvant, and then on day six you stop, and on day seven you look for protection. So it's a very short-term type of assay. And when you look at one day after having stopped, you see that, in fact, all mice are protected, and this is an assay that only looks at killer T-cell protection in these mice. So everything protects. But already 6 days or 10 days later, you know, the protection against the vaccination with only peptide completely disappears. Whereas for the immune adjuvant treated with peptide, it stays for, let's say, 40, 50 days. That's the depot you create. So just, you know, you put the antigen in and it just, re-stimulates the system. But the peptide has a half-life of 12 hours, so it's gone. And if the peptide is gone, the stimulation is gone and the protection is gone. Which, of course, questions, you know, whether use of peptides as simple anti-solid tumor vaccines ever is going to work. My prediction is, of course, it won't, because you need re-stimulation. So let's do that in a tumor situation. You set a tumor that usually grows without vaccination, interference. And of course, you know, you wait for 14 days before you start vaccination because, you know, to vaccinate before the tumor comes is an unfair experiment. You don't want to do that. So you wait 2 weeks and then you start vaccinating, because then you can palpate that the tumor is actually growing. Now you do one vaccination with either peptide or vaccinia recombinant or whatever you would like, and you look at the growth kinetics, no difference. Well, maybe 2 days delay, you know, but that's not what you want. So now you imitate what I've told you. You repeat the immunization every 2-3 days, many times. And now, you know, most will actually control the tumor. So it's a bit like your TB granuloma. You know, the TB granuloma doesn't usually become a huge TB problem because of this ongoing stimulus. And I think for tumors, it might be actually quite complex. Now, of course, the next question is, can you do that? Can you immunize it this way against the tumor without causing an immunopathology or autoimmunity? So let's take our GP, glycoprotein transgenic islet mouse, and take a tumor into which we have put in the same glycoprotein as a very strong defined tumor antigen. It's a methylcholandrin tumor. And now we vaccinate, you know, we combine that, so we have a islet GP transgenic mouse plus the tumor. And the question is, what can we do to get rid of the tumor without actually causing a diabetes? Well, you can't. You know, in a very careful titration on time and vaccine within a factor of two, you can't. Which practically means, you know, you have to make your decision and choice. Which often, you know, so, you know, why should the immune system respond against a papillomavirus-infected cell in the skin or against a methylcholandrin GP-expressing sarcoma? And the general idea is that these tumor cells go into the mouse or grow in the mouse, and it's macrophages or antigen-presenting cells that pick up that stuff and do not like classical dogma would have it, re-express it in MHC class 2, but would somehow, by mythological mechanism, put it into class 1, which is unconventional. And therefore, there is cross-presentation, that is, stuff is taken up and crosses into the class MHC class 1 pathway. Well, let's do the experiment. We take, let's say, a fibroblast of H2K, this is a transplantation antigen, and stick that into a BALB/CH2D mouse. So this is completely histo-incompatible, will be rejected. And then we check whether if you transfect a viral antigen, like nucleoprotein of VSV or glycoprotein of LCMV, whether this specificity translates into the host-restricted T-cell. If you don't understand this part, simply sleep over it. The immunologist will. So now you compare this, and you do all sorts of experiments. You cook the cells, you irradiate them, you sonicate them, you do it 10 times, you bring in 10 grams of the stuff. Doesn't help. You don't get an immune response. However, if you take the same allogeneic fibroblast, but in addition to the nuclear protein transgene, you add an MHC class 1, let's call it foreign transplantation antigen, namely the one that presents this antigen in the BALB/c mouse, now you find induction of a CTL response is easy. Actually, it's as efficient as the induction of a T-cell response done by dendritic cell. So dendritic cells are nothing special. Macrophages are nothing special. The only difference is a fibroblast usually doesn't migrate to the draining lymph node, whereas a dendritic cell, of course, does. But in terms of presentation, it's clear that if you titrate this versus this, the difference is 10 to the 6. That is, indirect, so-called cross-presentation is 10 a million times less efficient than direct presentation. So, I summarize. You know, tumor cells only in the periphery are no problem. I mean, immunologically, because they are not recognized and the T cells are never deleted, never. If the tumor cells get to the lymph node or spleen, immediately there will be CD8 effector cell induction by the tumor cell itself. So early, you could call it early metastasis, is good for you. Late metastasis usually is the end result of a selective process. And this, of course, is bad because the antigen is gone, the MHC is gone, all sorts of things. Now, of course, a special problem are the leukemias, because the leukemias are everywhere in the system, not maybe also outside, but primarily within the system. And this always has two consequences. The T cells are deleted, because that's what usually happens, or there's a mutational escape of the tumor by all sorts of things. And of course, the dream or the idea of cross-presentation is simply not going to work. Now, as I've said, you know, we all stand on the shoulders of giants. For myself, this is true as well. You know, I sort of have various lines of origin, Lausanne, Canberra, and then this Hamburg and Tübingen for the LCM virus. And this sort of ends up in my trio with Hans Hengarten and Peter Doherty. And I think it has been not only very interesting, but also a pleasure to follow the tricks of viruses, because I think we can learn a lot. And this was the lab reunion about 4 years ago. Many people, of course, have contributed, not only people, but also the institutions. Of course, Zurich is a good city. Thanks very much.